Well, good afternoon and welcome to a discussion that will be focusing on one of the most fundamental challenges that we could be talking about today. When we look at issues of unemployment, when we look at issues of equality, when we look at trying to deal with challenges from food security to dealing with technological revolutions and other issues, it often comes back to what is the role of business. And over the last few years, there have been some very strong criticisms of some of the excesses of business or some of the risks associated with systemic issues in the financial sector and others. At the same time, I think there's a strong realization that critical economic and social issues cannot be addressed without using the capital, the capabilities, and the competencies of the business sector. But really, what is clear is compared to the past when some would say the business of business is business, today the business of business is society. That, you know, business is an economic structure that has been created by societies to help meet their collective needs. And the license to operate a business can only be renewed if societies continue to believe that businesses can actually meet broader requirements than just those of the shareholders. Easy to say, hard to do, and yet so important. And so important in different ways for countries at different stages in their development. And that's what the conversation today is going to be very much about. Not just the general theories of the role of business in society, but what can businesses do for specific societies at specific stages in our development. And I'm so pleased to have with us a very talented and diverse group of leaders to help us discuss these issues and to provide their perspectives about what they and their organizations are doing with their societies. And let me start with Mahmood, Kooheji, the Chief Executive Officer of Bahrain Mumtalakat. And sir, Mumtalakat's played a very special role in the development of Bahrain. Hasn't existed very long, but has already had an enormous impact. Perhaps you could share with us its strategic intent and what you see as the CEO as being the way in which you're trying to balance the need to have business performance with meeting real social needs, sir.
Thank you very much for having me. I think your opening statement was really describing in my heart what Mumtalakat is all about. You know, if I can put it in a few words, it's growing the wealth of the Bahrain, of the people of Bahrain. Growing the wealth is not, it doesn't just come from financial wealth. It's a lot of things. I think part of our role is, and it's our duty, is to bring in, you know, international values into the portfolio that we are managing, to bring in transparency, to bring in best corporate governance. And once you do that one, then you really, you bring sustainability into the business you are working with. If we have the wealth of the people of Bahrain, we don't want them to wait until the end for them to get the fruit. It's our duty that they get the fruit as we go on through the journey. So our motto is, or our mission is, really let's do the process as we go on. We'd like the people of Bahrain to feel the benefit as we are doing our businesses, as we are going about our businesses. And I think it's very important that, you know, we are a new organization. Mumtalakat was established as part of a reform that the Bahrain government did in the country. Reform talks about, you know, a new way of doing. It's a, the way people look forward to. So it is very important for us that we have to lead by example. So we need to put our best corporate governance into our own organization and then roll it down into the other entities that we have. And we have been very actively introducing all of these sort of values and standard into the portfolio we have. There's a lot of examples we can talk about it. And I think the issue is not only financial result, it's corporate governance, transparency. It's developing the Bahraini people, Bahraini talent into this organization. And really, we start at the very top, at the board of director levels. We try to see in the board and say what type of talent we have there. And the way, the model that we have used, we try to merge the experience, and some, and many times, the international experience that there is, with the local Bahraini expertise that we have on the board, and we will never forget the younger generation that are coming in. For us, they are a very good value added in this board, because they are the people who will always pick up on the new ideas and really push for them. And we have seen that dynamic working very well in Bahrain. So when we do that sort of the board, the next step will be is that the board will be the model for the management of the companies. Because if they function properly, the management will be functioning properly, and then the whole process go down to whole organization. And that is a very important thing that we need to look at it as overall, that the Bahraini people, our shareholders, they need to benefit from all the activities that we do in the portfolio that we have. We have been there for 5-6 years. I think we have achieved a lot, but I can see the future is a lot for us to do achieve more there. I think the potential is a lot there. But the most important thing that we think about it every day, we need to lead by example. So we are very careful what we do, because everybody will look up to us. Mm-hmm. And they need to look up to us that we are doing it the right way.
One of the issues you talked about was the question of developing talent and making sure that you're actually providing the opportunities for people to actually take on these new positions. What, any particular challenges trying to do that in Bahrain? Any special ways in which Mumtalakat is trying to address this?
Yes, I think, you know, the challenge that we have is, you know, we are a small society and we are a small sort of pool of Bahrainis that are talented. It is very important that we don't go and try to reinvent the wheel. It is that these board of dynamics that we try to bring in the expertise, the international best practice into this board and then train them. And when we do that one, it is we don't just work as a normal institution. Mm-hmm. You know, we try to work with all our boards as a family of board members. So we try to, within our group, to dissipate information and dissipate knowledge. Yeah. We hold 2-3 times a year just social gathering where we sit and we allow each board members share the experience, share the knowledge they have, and share the challenge of them with each other. And not only that, the process we do it is, you know, we are the owner. And people always look at, I'm the owner, I can appoint or remove board of directors. What we do, we have a lot of process of, you know, talking and consultation and transparency. When we create a booklet for to govern our board members, the first thing we do is we put it to our board members in a casual session and say, is this workable or no? Do you can see any problem with it? And then we get a lot of feedback from them that are, you know, usually you don't think about it. The important about that one is if there is any problem, it disappears. But the most important thing is you get ownership. Mm-hmm. They feel that they are part of the making in the process. You know, it is not something that they are put to them. It's something that they were in the making of it. And you find a lot of commitment to it and, you know, it is implemented from the heart.
And it's interesting, this idea that Mumtalakat can contribute to Bahrain's development by bringing in these world-class governance approaches, diverse perspectives from around the world. And I know that actually in terms of the sovereign wealth funds, it scores one of the highest in terms of the global transparency measures as well. So that from that perspective, the high level helping the society, but also in terms of the training of Bahrainis locally, and we talk about education for employment, providing employment and therefore educating through the employment as well is a key element. Now this is with Bahrain, which is actually endowed with a certain riches, a certain base. If we now move to another part of the Middle East, which has an extremely important set of challenges, and Palestine, Samir, Hulileh, you're the Chief Executive Officer of the Palestine Development and Investment, PADICO Holding. How do you see your role in Palestine, and in particular, how do you measure success at the end of the year in terms of whether you're delivering both on the business and the social side?
I would say that there is a bit of a contradiction in what we do in Palestine, because in most of the world, making profit is something good. In Palestine, it's a controversial issue because people are busy resisting or busy dying or busy being imprisoned or busy, you know, there is a national cause. And exactly, making profit is not part of it. Making jobs is part of it. Mm-hmm. So this contradiction, I would say, was all the time inherent in the relationship that we have as a company with our public. And it was smooth maybe in the last 3-4 years only, not at the beginning. People, when they have, let's say, a poverty ratio of 43% in Gaza, and we are making $100 million of profit, what does it say to them? that we are succeeding, however they are impoverished. We are not the reason, but we are still next to them. So it wasn't easy. It needed a lot of sensitivity from our side, and it needed a lot of very strong messages on different levels, and I can tell you about some of them. We have started in 1993-94 by founders, Mr. Masri, the chairman, Mr. Khoury, the also board member. All of them were committed to investing in Palestine in particular. So we are one of the holding companies that cannot invest somewhere else. This is a commitment by itself, because during an intifada or during a problem, you cannot escape the country. This is your fate. And you have to make success out of investing in that country, no matter what the situation is. So first is committed to invest in Palestine. This tells a very strong message to people that we are with them in good and in bad. We are not running away when it comes bad, and we're not coming back only when there is an opportunity. Second, when we declared all the time that our policy of investment is not to compete with small investors, in particular projects less than $5 million is not part of our interest, and we have to look for strategic projects that will build something special, that will bring technology or know-how on management, etc. These kind of projects, like establishing the stock exchange in Palestine in 1996, or establishing or having the first telecom business in Palestine in 1996, the first power generation station in Gaza in 1996, and so on. So these projects needs deep pockets, needs a lot of technical assistance and technology transfer. And our choice of these projects is basically a reflection of this feeling that we have had with the people in that context. In addition, the corporate culture. Palestine didn't have a corporate culture. Mm-hmm. Palestine had few public shareholding companies before 94, and a lot of problems in the supervision and management of these of this culture. I think at least the wealth of experience that our shareholders have elsewhere in Europe, in the Gulf, and in Jordan have helped to create a corporate culture in Palestine. Now at least the stock exchange have 46 publicly listed companies, and this culture, I would say, is dominant in a sense. A fourth dimension we have at least used is to choose environmental projects. People sometimes choose environmental projects because they are specialized in it. We are not. We are, again, a holding company. We can go into ICT or trading or just name it. But we have chosen environmental projects, in particular in Gaza, but also West Bank, solid waste recycling, sewage treatment plants, desalination plants, etc., just to make sure that we are working not just in high tech that brings money to us, not in telecom, not in banking, but also in really something that is very dirty, people would not like any way to invest in, and they will be proud that we are investing with them in it. It's not just we are choosing the best of the sectors, but also every single sector that brings something good for them. However, in all what I have said, it doesn't yet deal with the corporate responsibility component of what we do. Living in a country where you have a lot of poverty and a lot of agony means that hundreds of people will be waiting at your door asking for some help. Not for personal help. It could be for cultural activities. It could be for, I mean, just name it, everything. A government that is almost with a deficit, a political confrontation, sometimes high, sometimes low. So this puts on us huge pressures on trying to engage with the people in these needs. Thanks God, the Arab Spring came in last year. Because with the Arab Spring, we, for the first time, we could challenge all our people that we are determined to work on the issue of youth. Youth employability is our preference, is our choice, and we would like to put all our social responsibility component into that direction. And I'll tell you that we have created a program on that context. I can speak about it during the session. But at least we are focused on this component after 2011.
We'll come back to the question of youth employment. But before that, I'm struck by the idea that you define part of your role as identifying white space. We always talk about strategic white space for companies. It's an unmet consumer need, but you're almost saying it's an unmet societal need or key economic need. And that's where you try to focus so you're not competing with things that the small or medium enterprises could be doing. And how do you go about doing that and identifying that?
Look, it's if you are living there, that's extremely important. At the end of the day, our investors came from outside the country. We are diaspora Palestinians who are living in diaspora outside, and they are investing inside the West Bank and Gaza and Jerusalem. So this diaspora does not mean necessarily that you know the place, you know the system, you know the people. It needs time. And it took us like 15 years to get to realize what are the sentiments within the West Bank Gaza. With all the goodwill you could have, it could be completely misinterpreted by a single businessman who thinks that you are just following up your profit immediately, you're going for trading, you doesn't care about the poor. A lot of slogans could come out, especially under pressure. So again, the sensitivity is the most important. And remember, we are publicly listed. Whatever people say is will affect our share, will affect the price of our stock. So you have to take care of the public opinion and of the stereotype a lot during our story, during our work.
So Damian, Gammell, we've just been hearing about Bahrain Mumtalakat, basically whose shareholders are the Bahraini people, a government structure with an independent governance system, and now in with PADICO in Palestine, publicly listed, but also with the engagement of the diaspora, so where the Palestinians abroad can contribute to Palestine there, both with the role they play. You represent as the chief executive officer of Coca-Cola, Içecek in Turkey, a global player with global capabilities, very deeply involved in the particular areas that you work in. How do you see your responsibility and Coca-Cola's responsibility in terms of the relationship with the communities and the countries that you're involved in, and particularly the ones that you're most engaged in now?
Thanks, Robert. good afternoon. I think you've got to start with a few givens. I think transparency and accountability are definitely going to continue to be themes that all companies and businesses are going to be held up against, and that's certainly the case for a business like Coca-Cola. We're in 206 countries. I mean, we're a global business, but in essence, we're very local. We've 700,000 employees. In my region alone, we've over 20,000 from here to Pakistan. We've over 40 production sites. So we are globally accountable, but we're very much, in essence, a very local business. And our DNA is local. I mean, we started off as a very local business 126 years ago. So we firmly believe that this new era of accountability, transparency, demands from our own shareholders, demands from our employees, demands from our partners, is a positive thing. I mean, we don't look at this as a negative. In some ways, I think it's a fantastic development that it's getting so much airtime. And there's so much pressure on companies and people and organizations and governments to move this agenda forward. So I think it's positive. When I look at it specifically in the region I operate within, I also think we're going back in history. I think if you look back previously, businesses, society, governments, NGOs as they existed at the turn of the century were very, very close. I mean, you really couldn't start a business without having the goodwill of your neighbors, the goodwill of your community. And businesses generally started off in small, family operated, and then grew. And I think what's happened over a number of years is as organizations got too big, you know, some of that DNA that existed and exists in the Bahrain example and in the Palestine example today got lost. So as a global organization, you know, we see the opportunity to kind of leverage that to be a strength going forward. One thing that I would caution against is that you've got to get it right in-house first. So certainly our challenge within Coca-Cola is how do we get our 700,000 employees engaged, believing, and acting in a way that supports that goal as much as going outside first. I mean, I think if it's not part of your own culture, your own DNA, whatever you do outside is going to lack credibility. So we see kind of pressure coming from stakeholders, shareholders, and interestingly also coming from employees. I was in Iraq 2 weeks ago, where we just opened up a new sales office in Baghdad, and I was interviewing people for managerial jobs, and you might think, given where Iraq's at, that it was very easy to get people to say, I want to come and work for you, and, you know, where do I sign? It was amazing the number of questions I got about our social responsibility practices. You know, how did we view communities in Iraq? What was our policy on water? Yeah. So that's coming from the top and the bottom, and that's a good thing. And I think companies have got to embrace that, be very open towards it, but also not be afraid to put pressure back. So, you know, one of the challenges we have is how do we empower our employees? So as much as they look to us in terms of shareholder leadership, we're also saying, okay, we'll empower you. What can you do in your local community? So I think it's a positive thing. I think it's some ways going back in time, history repeating itself. But the key challenge for all organizations is it's got to be an internal agenda first. Yeah. And only then can you bring it with credibility to society.
And when you look at Iraq, for example, what do you hope Coke's going to be providing there? So if the employees of the community were looking 5 years from now and they'd say, well, in addition to having a fine beverage, you know, what have you done? What have you changed? What would you like to be measured against?
I mean, there's many studies and the multiplier effect, and I'm not going to talk about that. Everybody knows those numbers, right? What I do think is often overlooked is what organizations bring in terms of capabilities. So, you know, a lot of people join our organization and leave, and that's the nature of every business. But when we set up a business like any other organization, you tend to bring new capabilities, you know, whether it's in the area of quality, health and safety, different expectations in terms of accounting, transparency, corporate governance. And any organization within its four walls builds that capability, and that gets transferred into society. It can be transferred by people leaving and becoming an entrepreneur, social or business. It can be transferred by them using those skills in their own endeavors, sports clubs, charity work, community work. So I think one of the power of any organization, not just Coke, any organization, is that you have a chance to seed new capabilities in these countries or enhance ones that exist by investing in them. So the economic benefits, the multipliers, the supplier, the value chain, I mean, all that is well documented. And that is a benefit. But I think the legacy is that you help to breed and inculcate a new level of leadership in the society. And, you know, our reality is and our hope is that a lot of people will join Coke and leave and go on and do bigger and better things that will benefit their community and the country at large. So that capability multiplier is something that doesn't get talked about.
Yeah.
It's very hard to quantify, and I think it's a big, big benefit.
And there's no, so this idea of the individual capabilities and the broader competencies and mindsets. I'm going to move to a different perspective in just a moment, but let me just, before I leave that, what do the three of you find the most difficult or the most challenging situation now? Because we're talking about the things where businesses are making positive contributions. This is all great. But there's a lot of criticism of business. There's a lot of criticism, particularly in this region of business. What do you see as some of the challenges? Not necessarily talking about your organization, but just talking more broadly. What are the more, you know, some of the legitimate criticisms or shortcomings of businesses that need to be addressed over the next few years? Please.
I thought that during the Arab Spring, I was terrified by the fact that the private sector in the region is connected to government and to governments and to parties and to corruption and so on. And this was, to be frank, a nightmare for us, because if that reflect on how our people and our public opinion will be the case in Palestine, not just in Egypt or Tunisia, then we are in real trouble. So that's the best thing we have done. Immediately we have studied this carefully. We have had few workshops in Palestine all over between, again, the private sector and other representatives from the community to make sure that we are not a replicate of what was happening in Egypt with Ahmed Izz or with whoever is in Tunisia or and so on. However, it's not the only issue. Again, I would say that to manage the public opinion or to manage the perception of the company is the most sensitive issue now. And this needs a lot of IR and PR, a lot of work that has to be done. And it's not just words. It's not a technical skill. It's something genuine that you have to do within the company that reflects and overflow on the public. And that's why doing it for your own, again, in our strategy of investment, it's an integral part of the investment. It's an integral part of employment. It's not just an outside, I would say, again, a PR component, but it needs a lot of management that we didn't use before. And I think this is now the challenge for the coming year or two, minimum.
For business to show that they're truly separate to deal with these issues.
To be. We have to really be that. We have to meet the expectations when it comes to employability, when it comes to how the transparency that we, look, there are a lot of cliches in what we do. We can easily say that we are transparent. But if people does not believe that we are, what can we do? Yeah. You have to be serious about it. It's not simple. You are not going to fool the masses of youth that are there around. Their governments could not fool them. And the 30 or 40 years of governing them with all the instruments they would have could not fool the youth and the public. So it's not a matter of just a face that you have to show. It's something integral, it's something internal, and you have to believe in it. And again, this will determine the future of the business in our communities if we are not going to be just international and run away from Palestine or Egypt or whatever. We are saying here we have to face the public and we have to deal with their perceptions.
So that critical issue of trust.
Yes, to build.
And this issue of trust comes up not only here, but also comes up globally as well. And Katherine Garrett-Cox, in fact, trust is built into the name of the corporation that you are the chief executive officer of, Alliance Trust. And in that sense, it's built in, but it's also one of an industry that actually has lost a lot of trust of people in the financial industry over the last many years. How do you, as CEO, look at this issue of trust and look at the role of the financial institutions, particularly now?
Thank you, Robert. Well, you're absolutely right. Having trust as part of your name is probably a great opportunity as much as something that we have to overcome at the moment. But we're an organization that's been in existence actually for nearly as long as you, for 124 years. And we've seen a lot of change over that period of time. Not many chief executives, I'm only the ninth, so I see my career mapped out ahead of me. But I think, you know, to really answer your question, I think you need to understand why trust was lost. And I think, yes, a lot of blame has been laid at the door of financial services institutions, and it's absolutely clear that some people did display extremely bad behavior. But the reality is everyone was happy to live like that. For decades, we've lived beyond our means. We've been very happy to overconsume. We've been very happy to take easy credit conditions. And the reality is that, you know, we're now suffering a massive bout of indigestion. So I think the really critical part of this is the restoration of trust, in my humble opinion, will come through a rebuild of confidence. Because if you're confident in something, whatever it is, you typically tend to have a bit more trust in it. So I think that's really the key to unlocking it. And so right now, I mean, everyone's talking about leadership and the style and I suppose approach of strong leadership that we need to see displayed across the world, whether it's in the political arena or in the business arena. And I think for the trust to really be felt, we have to behave better as leaders. So for instance, what tangible things should we be doing? I think we've heard a lot of these things here. I think, firstly, as a leader, I think you need to be very clear what drives you. Because if you're not authentic, people won't trust you. So you need to be very, very honest with yourself, what you're good at, what you're not so good at. So I think having a very strong moral compass, it may sound trite, but I think it's really important. I think along with that, and this picks up some of the themes we've already had, you need to be very open and transparent, not only in the way that you engage with your employees, because if people, everyone is searching for leadership. It's not just people outside the organization, it's people inside the organization. And so they want to have, a sense of confidence in you. I think you need to be transparent. Absolutely, it goes without saying. We're a publicly quoted company and have been since 1888, so it goes without saying. But I think the other point is that you need to have a very clear strategy and you need to stick to it. I mean, how many times have we seen people say, well, I was doing this and now I've changed my mind and I'm now going over here? And that's when people lose confidence. So I think be clear about what you're doing, be true to your mission, be open and transparent. And then I think as leaders, then we will restore trust, particularly in the financial services sector.
An interesting issue about the fact that lots of people were happy to live with the illusion that it was possible to have the massive amounts of debt and that this would continue to go on in terms of increasing real estate prices and so on. What's the role and responsibility of businesses in terms of that dialogue with consumers and with governments in terms of what's realistic, what's appropriate in terms of regulations, or what's appropriate in terms of self-regulation and kind of collective financial literacy around some of these issues? And maybe, and what concretely are you or should others be doing on this?
Well, I think on a concrete basis, if you get asked to do something useful, do it. At the end of last year, I was appointed to the UK Prime Minister's Business Advisory Group, and it's very clear to me that he wants to hear what business has to say on these issues. So I think that actually an engagement around that really helps. So to what degree, what is the nexus between the political world and the business world? I think, you know, the other point is that we have a responsibility as a financial services business with over 60,000 shareholders that touch probably far more people in the UK. We do have a duty of care to help people learn, but it's not just about one particular sort of group or demographic. You have to touch them all. So on a tangible basis, as an organization, we've been running very active pensions workshops in the UK. So we go up and down the country, we engage with people, we help them understand why you need to save your pension because the UK government isn't going to give you any money. Secondly, we're engaging with the universities locally. So we loan out some of our better employees to the universities to actually teach on a practical basis what they're doing in a theoretical basis in universities. And then lastly, again, around the whole financial literacy point, we engage with school children. We basically have an annual program where we bring in about 20, 15, and 16-year-olds, and we bring them in. We educate them on why it's not a great idea to borrow with a credit card with an APR of 30%, the power of compounding, again, why you need to start to save. And I think that we as an organization and the financial services sector in general has a duty of care to help educate people who are coming after us, because then at least they know what they're getting and they won't be doing it from the basis of ignorance.
And just sort of from a buyer beware to a buyer be aware kind of approach, which is actually a very different responsibility than perhaps business saw themselves as having a few years ago.
Well, I think you're never too young to learn.
Yes. Now, Ozgur Tanrikulu, you're with McKinsey and Company. You've been spent many years in the United Arab Emirates, but you're actually Turkish and you're coming back to Turkey.
That's correct.
I mean, given the conversation here and also what you've observed, I mean, what do you think is driving the fact that the expectations of business seem so different than perhaps they were a few years ago? That's the easy part of the question. The second part of the question will be, as the head of the McKinsey office here in Turkey, what will you be doing to actually improve the positive role of business?
Let me start with the easy one first. A lot of very interesting examples, and I think that really highlights the fact that there's a lot of soul searching going on right now with respect to the business and its role in society. I think life used to be simpler a couple of decades ago. I mean, as a business leader, there was an implicit social contract, or contract with the society. And what that contract said is, you know, make money, but please do it in a clean way, right? Don't engage in corruption. Make sure you have good labor practices. Make sure you don't pollute the environment. And then you're free to just do whatever you want to do, and just, you know, and profit is the bottom line, and that's all there is to it. The problem is, and that was the whole, you know, business of business is business, basically, thinking. The problem is it's much more complicated right now as we look at what's going on. There is an expectation from the business leaders to do a lot more than that. So, I mean, in the words of the Harvard professor Joseph Nye, effectively, the business leaders now have to be this triathletes, right? So you're not just a business leader running a business, but you're also supposed to have a government head, a public head, as well as a society head, and be able to become a leader that can run all these three in parallel, which is quite challenging. And it is challenging because especially in the, you could say, in the Western markets where the view of the markets are very short term, and the expectation from a CEO is very short term in terms of quarterly results, whereas a lot of the activities one has to engage in on the social side are actually quite long term and in nature. And by all sense of purposes, they pay off, but it just takes, you know, years, sometimes decades. And many of the times now, CEOs aren't staying that long, right? The tenures have come down. Now, what are the trends behind all of this? I think many of the trends are quite obvious to all of us. Clearly, there is the whole sense of technology, right? From a sort of, if you wish, one-to-many technological view, right, where a common media just went out, we're now in the many-to-many zone where anybody on many technological platforms can basically raise their perspectives. And immediately, if you are a business leader that is not contributing to the society or doing things that the society doesn't feel happy about, that just gets disseminated all over the place, right? So I think technology is a big driver of that, and that's not that's quite obvious. But I do think there's another dimension which is probably a bit more challenging to solve, and that is life has just also got a lot more complicated. So the types of problems that the society is facing is probably a lot more complicated today, because people have now the expectation across all the world to have access to services and products, you know, at a level that is just way higher than what it used to be. Because again, technology shows them, you get on the internet and you know what is the type of product service you can have. And the problem is the governments, which were the typical, you know, vehicles to solve for those problems, are just not naturally equipped to solve for that. So it goes back into the business to be able to, and the governments are saying, I want you to help me with the problems that I am facing today. Governments are sometimes taking the market state role, right? The market governments are saying, tell me how I can basically grow my economy. Tell me how you're going to help me with youth and unemployment. I was having a discussion the other day with one of the, again, government leaders. You know, education, which is a major problem for many of the governments. And governments are, again, looking back at business and say, tell us, you seem to be doing a lot of great training.
And so now the hard part of the question. So what do you do to help businesses bridge that gap?
Yeah, the hard part of the question is one easy side of it, actually. And the easy side is as follows. What I'm seeing is in many of the if you wish, the developing markets or markets like Turkey, actually many businesses are already quite capable, because to succeed in Turkey, you had to have, or many of developing countries, you had to have that three hats on you, right? Because just the nature of the job required you to have the capability to be able to not just be a good business leader, but also help, you know, support the society. So, and in a way, the way, for example, we have discussion with all the senior leaders, they're not just business discussions. You start from a business discussion, and what you find out is actually it immediately moves into to solve for that specific issue, you need to look at a vocational education solution. A number of the business leaders, and therefore, in a way, I have to carry that multiple hats myself too, which is a challenge. You have to be able to talk about how do we solve, for example, a labor and a quality of labor issue in terms of the right capability of skills. And then you need to be able to talk about what are the type of education solutions one brings on board as a corporate leader.
Now I'm going to make sure we actually get comments as well as questions from the audience in just a moment. But the one element I want to draw upon is this issue of drawing upon the best talent. And this issue of how does one, as business, ensure that it's a truly meritocratic system where the best talent is involved, regardless of gender, regardless of ethnic background, religious background, and what role does business play, and how does that play out? And what examples are there? How does Bahrain Mumtalakat look at this issue of diversity?
Okay, I think follow up to his question, consultants do play a very good, important role in bringing the knowledge that's outside there into the company. But when you come into it, Bahrain is a very sort of rich in manpower, yet we are a very open society. You know, if we talk about Mumtalakat, we have something like 8-9 nationalities. When you look at the portfolio companies, we have a lot of nationalities. I think it's very important that you create that culture. You know, if I use an example, you know, one of the portfolio companies that we're working with, when we first went in, we realized, you know, they had 7 type of employment contracts, differentiating between people, what gender they're coming from, what area they're coming from. We said, that's not right. We abolished that one, and we put one contract for all the employees. That really put everybody together. They put, you know, united employees all, that they are all are doing the same job, but they're paid for the same job. Having said that, there is opposite approach as well. Once you that one, there are people that you need to look at them especially. And here I'm talking about, you know, trying to empower women. You know, when we put everybody equally together, we said, but you as a woman have a special needs. So we had a session where we found out, you know, what is common between them, what we can offer them so they will be more empowered. And we found out, you know, the requirements were very, very small, very minimum. It was a process of transparency and dialogue and listening to them. And it was, you know, it created, you know, that bond with the company that there is a unity and everybody's working as a teamwork. To me, I think transparency is very important, and not to start all over from yourself. You know, don't shy away from to go outside there and bring the best talent to bring you the expertise that other people share in other countries, and start from where other people ended up. Don't start from the beginning. So there is.
Damian, do you want to build on that?
I don't want to frighten everybody, but I'm sure if we had this room full of 15, 16-year-old teenagers from across the globe, they'd probably go, what you guys are talking about is already history. We're worried about what's, you know, what's going to come next. So I think one of the challenges for all organizations is, you know, how do we change our systems and our culture to allow all of these diverse insights in? I mean, I'm sure in one of the most famous banks that ended up collapsing, for many years there was probably people in that organization saying, we should be more transparent, we should be more ethical, we should be more, you know, open. And many organizations crush the diverse voice within them. So I think as an insurance policy for organizations, in order not to miss the next agenda or to help create the next agenda, I think diversity is key. But I think it's diversity along insights, employees, religion, culture, opinions. So I think having an organization that embraces diversity across a number of areas is a big challenge, because there's corporate cultures, there's history, there's the way the boss does it, and if you do it the way the boss does it, you'll get promoted. And for sure, all organizations have to ask themselves, how did we miss some of these big trends that have come at us like a tidal wave? Yeah. And not use them as a competitive advantage, because I'm sure if the first bank that came out and said, we're going to be the most transparent, the most social, the most open bank, you know, that could have been a huge competitive advantage. So this diversity agenda, to me, is far bigger. It's about changing the way organizations operate and the systems, and helping leaders to be really comfortable with having different opinions in the same room, different cultures, sex, religion, whatever. And to me, that's a given now. The challenge is changing organizations that are 124 years old, 126 years old, or new with strong leaders.
That might be given for you as a young global leader.
Yeah.
Right. There may be other people for whom that's not quite so given yet. And yeah. And I'm reminded of a speaker earlier here who talked about the ghetto of the like-minded. You know, you sort of cluster all together, and it's funny that you don't see the new things happening. Katherine, you've been thinking a lot about this. I mean, how do you, because Mumtalakat's a real leader on the whole issue of both genders being involved in the workplace in Bahrain. But in the UK, how's it going?
Well, hopefully as a woman, I'm the best qualified on this panel to talk to this issue. But, you know, I think we've made great progress, but I think we're a bit stuck in some senses. So I think there is a business case for a genuinely better sense of balance in the business environment. And that's how I see it. I don't see it as diversity as such. I think in a way it's quite a tired word. I wish we could find a different way to reframe the argument. So I see it as balance. But actually, it's much more than that. It's about competitive advantage. And if you think about it, for any company or indeed any country to be sustainably competitive, you want the best people, because we are unique in and of themselves. We can't easily be cloned. So you want to engage the best people. And I think one of the interesting statistics is that we've talked a lot this summit about crisis and how we get out of it. And I think we're almost so much mired in the crisis, we really can't see the wood for the trees. And we're scrabbling around looking for solutions. But I think this whole discussion links to a potential solution, which is around the SME sector. And if you look at the SME sector on a global basis, you know, not only does it typically promote innovation, but it also gives you a safe place to fail. You know, people like to experiment. And I think if you take risks, you generally can do better. So if you look in Europe, 30% of all entrepreneurs are women. And if you actually broaden out the discussion and look at it in an economic basis, 70% of all decisions made by consumers, you know, are female related. So actually, we have to try and find a way to engage women in a broader context. I mean, I was struck by a report I was reading which said that 1/4 of the world's population are rural women. Mm-hmm. And I found it incredibly surprising and yet quite depressing. So we do need to engage. In the UK, we've made some strides. Actually, at a corporate level, Alliance Trust is a bit of a trailblazer. We are the only FTSE 350 company with a female chairman and chief executive, and we also have 50% female on our board. So we're not just talking about it, we're actually doing it, which I think is very important. I mean, there's been a perennial discussion around quotas. How do you move forward? Of course, Norway introduced a quota system in 2003, and they're very proud of the fact that now 40% of their business positions at board level are held by women. But when you drill down and look at it, only 2% of them are chief executives. So that's kind of my point, that I think on the face of it, it looks like we've made a lot of progress. I still think there's a long way to go.
It's interesting, we look back over the last few minutes, the role in terms of bringing in world-class capabilities and governance mindsets, that you've actually filling critical space in the economic and social needs of a community, bringing in capabilities and leadership approaches that actually cannot be used just only in the company but outside, this idea of a kind of rebuilding trust, providing the space for diversity to actually flourish in all its different elements, and actually the recognition of the fact that the role of business has changed. So it's not a matter of business has lost its way, let's go back to some nirvana of the past. It's no, the world has changed. We got to go forward to actually keep up with the changing expectations. I mean, challenging context, but let me now just turn to the audience if there's any comments, questions that people have or points that they would like to make themselves. Please, sir, and if I could ask you to introduce yourself and perhaps in no more than 30 seconds or 1 minute, lay out either your question or your comment. Please.
It's a comment, if you don't mind.
That's we fine.
Jamal Fakhra from Bahrain. I think, I totally agree with all the comments here. I think we have the whole environment of doing business is being changed over the years. We have lost lots of our values in doing business. We have lost integrity in doing business. I think people started to really to look into the bottom line before looking into the assets of the company. People become very greedy, looking after the money. We are not looking into people development agenda. I mean, everybody is talking about people agenda, training, people development, professionalism, all that. Unfortunately, in the past few years, we can see it going down, and that is one of the reasons. Definitely, we have all the problem in the financial services. I mean, we need really to go back to basics. We need to go back to check and balance. We need to give much more empowerment to the government agencies. Government agencies in the recent years are really very much proactive. Yeah. Once an issue happens, then they start to be very much proactive, where they really give lots of difficulty for the business to restart again. Talk about Sarbanes-Oxley, talk about POCB, talk about the SEC, the EU regulations. I mean, really, these are all reactive, and they are not very helpful. The other bit is the role of the business leader and the civil societies. Unfortunately, in most of the countries, and I think Europe is part of them, they do call business leaders to come to participate in discussions. They do call civil societies to come to discussion. But when it goes to the politicians, it will have a different view. So really, that link between the politicians, business community, the civil society, need to be much more stronger.
Excellent point. So the whole issue of the relationship between governments and business around this world is great. Let's take one or two more comments and then come back to the panel for comments on the comments. Any other questions? Sir.
I'm Carlos Piedrahita from Colombia, South America. And I would say that I very much agree with the panelist and with you, Robert, on what you have said. And I would say that this is all summed up in two perspectives. One is ethical and the other one is practical. It has to be ethical because it has to be from a conviction, whether it is accountability, transparency, balance in gender, and so on. It has to start from a conviction, and that's basically an ethical position. But also we have to recognize there is a practical angle to this, and that means all the stakeholders, consumers, and so on. We have to realize that consumers, especially the young consumers in masses, are taking collective decisions vis-a-vis their consumption, what they buy, the products, and so on. So they can be blocked, and if there is not a good behavior in the company or in the brands they perceive. So I believe this is basically a sustainable development issue, and basically has to do with ethics and pragmatic view.
Excellent. Any other comments or questions? Let me actually turn back on those two, because I think the issue of the role of government, but also the idea of the role of the citizen consumer, the idea that actually, in some cases, citizen action can completely bypass the need for regulation to put pressure on companies to change behavior, which is a relatively new but certainly, you know, quickly, massively accelerating issue. Samir, did you want to comment on
that? Yeah, I think there is a major difference between the MENA region and the rest of the world. Sorry, not the rest of the world, but the Western world. Governments and democracies generally improves and goes parallel to how their private sector moves. The speed is not the same. They lag behind a bit, but still it's the same. I'm talking about education, social services, and so on. They are more or less connected. In the Middle East, what happened is that we have seen at least 30 or 40 years difference. So what kind of curriculum we have in our schools? It's 30, 40 years ago. We were still reading the Green Book in Gaddafi, Libya, just recently. And this complete parity difference between how the governments, exactly how governments were providing their basic services, education and health, for example, and how the private sector was moving speedily in a global world. We were running. We always thought that it's not our responsibility educating our people. We always thought it's the government's responsibility. If they do it, it's fine. If they don't do it, it's their responsibility. I think now we're realizing that we are the agents of change. We are the one who are global. Our governments could be democratic, could be not democratic. We could be under occupation. We could not be free countries. In all the cases, we are responsible as if we are the only one responsible. We have to take a responsibility in that component. Because we are the global ones, we are the fastest of those agents of changes in our community. In our case in Palestine, I wanted just to mention one component, which is the workforce. We cannot import laborers from outside the country at any level, including foreigners, Americans, British. They cannot come except as a tourist visas on 3 months, which means that we are Our fate is to educate our graduates, our locals. And the problem is that it will cost us money, and it will be much smaller, much slower. It will need years of work to gain the experience. They don't have this experience locally. So we know it's a more painful process, but it's a must. It's a destiny for us. And I think this is something that we have realized lately. We have surrendered to the fact that you cannot just say it's somebody else's responsibility. Ultimately, it will be ours. And we have to take it proudly and to take it courageously and to find some help if we can. But again, this is the way I see things happening.
Really interesting point. Let me build also on this issue of the responsibility for the education of the youth. And I want to come back to the point that many of you mentioned, which is youth unemployment. I mean, it's a critical issue in many countries. Spain, it's almost 50% youth unemployment. But in the Middle East, there's a unique situation in terms of high levels of unemployed and high levels of university-educated unemployed. So what's the role and responsibility of business generally? But also, let me ask you, what are each of you doing? So if we came back a year from now or 2 years from now, we could talk about the progress. And why don't we actually just go around?
We have looked carefully into this because we have around, for example, women are now graduating from our universities in a ratio of 55-56%, while men are 45. However, when it comes to unemployment or how much of the women are enrolled in work, it's around 17%. So it shows the parity. Now, in general, both men and women, those who are getting a university degree, are doomed not to have any job, while those who are completely either illiterate or they don't have any experience are basically having their jobs and they are happily ever after. So the problem, this dichotomy means, look, at the beginning we thought it could be our responsibility, but when we digged into the issue, it's not exactly alone. Our universities in Palestine, we have 230,000 students in our universities. So we have 40,000-50,000 graduates every year. Well, really, we don't need that number. And most of them are learning education, Sharia, history, sociology, just name it. They are not engineers, they are not technical people. So there is a public policy component that has to be tackled, and it's a major issue. I have seen it in Israel. Israel have solved this problem 10 years ago. They were having the same kind of problem, and they have changed their education policy. And now, as I see it, it's balanced. I think we need first a role with the authority. We will be ready to look into our responsibility in that component, in particular the employability and preparing these kids or these graduates to what we need. And there is a third component that is in the people themselves, the youth. Mm-hmm. Youth has to be able to learn, has to be responsible people. They have to know what they want. There is a lot of responsibility on their shoulder also, and we cannot just take it away from them. So I think this kind of alliance, this kind of relationship is what is required in after the Arab Spring in this region.
Damian, I'm afraid we only have about 3 minutes left. So,
we firmly believe in this region. I mean, and we're investing $400 to $500 million a year just into the Middle East region in terms of facilities, capacity, people. So,
and on youth?
And most of that's in terms of, if you look at who's coming into work in our businesses, is the youth in the region. So we're certainly looking to attract the best talent in the region, build the best talent. And what we would look for is for the politicians to continue to create a stable environment, because has been talked about throughout the whole conference, is that stability really allows entrepreneurs to invest and businesses to invest. So, we would hope that, even today across the region, while stability is better, we know there's many areas that need to be addressed. So with stability will come investment. And I think that investment, our commitment is to do it in a sustainable, diverse, and with a long-term view, and I think that's good for the region. And we're committed to listening as well, because I think we don't know what we don't know, right? So we want our ears open, not just our wallets.
But allow me, let me share one experience that we have at Bahrain. The government, part of the reform, have created a fund. The fund very simply takes money from the private sector, and it's controlled and decided by the private sector. In a fund. That fund is around, it varies between 200 to short of $300 million a year. Half of the fund goes to really develop people who are working in the private sector, people who are employed that they want to get improving their jobs or skills or employability. But the other half goes encouraging SMEs, because we think that is really sustainable to private sector development, that we need to encourage people not to look for a job, but start their own businesses and be a private sector sort of contributor in the future. Let me share with you one success story. I was very touched with it. I joined this fund some time ago and left, but earlier in the fund, a lady came in with a problem to the fund. And her problem was very simple. She had school kids she could not take to school. She wanted help. And they told her, look, we don't give you this type of help. What we will do is we'll set up a business for you. How about if we give you a bus and you can take your kids and the neighbors to school and earn living out of it? I was happy that when I joined that fund, 2 years later, or maybe a year and a half later, the husband came in. He wanted to quit his job and he wanted to join his wife in the business to expand their businesses. So these are elements that I think we need to put in the society, and we need to encourage people to be in the SMEs. That's the future.
30 seconds, Katherine.
Okay. Well, the regular staff, internships, work placements, we do all of that. But the other thing we do is we support a local Scottish charity that helps youth unemployment by giving people grants of between £250 and £20,000 to do exactly this, to start their own business. Because the reason that youth unemployment needs to be tackled is because we need people like that in the workforce. We need more jobs. The trick to solving the global crisis is not sitting around talking about it, it's to create jobs.
Yeah. Ozgur.
I think it's been very well said. The answer lies in education for employment, right? How do we actually create the right education model that will enable employment? It's not that there are no jobs out there. There are actually millions of jobs in across MENA markets. It's just we don't have the right employment to create the, if you wish, the supply for those jobs. We're running an internal initiative which is basically looking at a multiple market education for employment initiative, try to understand what are the primary levers, how to change the perception around, for example, vocational schools, which are very, very critical. Yeah. Yet you find a lot of students hesitating to take those for several reasons, and really try to create, you know, different vehicles to be able to educate the kids for those jobs that are out there.
And I guess in a sense, we end up where we started, which is part of the dialogue between companies and the community in terms of what's actually possible, in terms of what's possible in terms of financial and loans, what's possible in terms of employment. So people know, okay, here's the kind of skills we need. Here's the kind of skills we can provide employment for. So whether it's colleges designing their curriculum or students deciding where to go, they actually can do it knowing where the likelihood is for them to actually find an opportunity. Well, it's been an hour that's passed very quickly with a lot of different perspectives. I hope actually we also have a chance to come back in a couple of years and actually see how each of you in different ways has helped move this forward. But in the meantime, I'd like to ask everybody to join me in thanking our panel here today.